Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Well, I'd like to say first of all what a great pleasure it is to be here this evening. We're meeting back in Berlin, where I've made many visits across the years, but never to the Hertie School. I'd like to thank Helmut especially for what I thought was a really charming introduction and a nice personalized introduction. With however some mistakes in it, because
I never really approved of the Blair Schroeder paper, which seemed to me didn't have enough protection for workers in the version that they produced. And when I wrote my book Third Way, I felt it in many ways quite different from how it was actually incorporated into politics by social democratic groups, including the Labour Party. So that's the fate of the intellectual in politics, really. It's quite hard to make a connection, which is a connection you want, because your ideas are picked up and then they're used in quite different ways. And it's quite difficult, straddling the political and the academic worlds. You find that both worlds tend to disown you, actually. But Helmut was a great influence at the LSE and at USC as well. UCLA, where I also was for a period, so our careers overlap quite a lot. And I just like to say what an amazing achievement the Hertie School is, because it hasn't existed for that long, not quite as long as my alma mater, King's College, Cambridge, really. And it's got this extraordinary reputation, and it's well known everywhere, and this is quite an amazing turnout this evening. So I think, Helmut, you've done, and everybody else sitting here involved with the Hertie School, has done a wonderful job, and it's a great privilege for me, therefore, to come and speak here this evening. I hope you will forgive me speaking English style, which is, without a coat and without a tie and sort of standing here rather than up there. And I know from many previous visits to Germany, it's not usually the way you do things, but I hope you'll indulge me. I just like to have a closer contact with the audience. I think it's sort of a good way to communicate. And you have to tell me at the back if you can't hear what I'm saying because of this mic. I think most other people, if they want to, should take off their coats because, it's blooming hot in this room. The theme of this lecture, ladies and gentlemen, this evening is transformation. I want to argue that we're living through possibly the greatest technological transformation ever in human history. A big claim, but I want to make it, in terms of its depth, in terms of its speed, and in terms of its global scope. And this series of transformations is driven by the digital revolution, a revolution which I want to claim in a minute or two has not been well understood to date in much of the social sciences. Let me give you just a couple of examples to drive home the point. In the earlier part of my career that Helmut was referring to, I wrote, believe it or not, a couple of books on the origins of the early civilizations. You don't have any civilization without writing, basically. Writing is the condition of the emergence, or one of them, of the traditional civilizations. If you look at the history of writing, it took about 10,000 years to percolate even to 4 or 5 civilizations across the world. And it was always confined, to a very small group of literate people until you get all the way through to the 19th century, actually. But the invention of writing seems to me quite a close analog to the coming of the internet, because the internet has had just an amazing impact on all our lives, from our personal lives through to our global futures. And the speed with which this has happened is just completely staggering, especially if you consider that the internet is both the vehicle of intensified globalization and the outcome of intensified globalization in communications. The internet in its contemporary form, you know, has a history going back about 30 or 40 years. But in terms of its real spread, you're talking basically only a period of some 20 years, and it is everywhere. I don't think there is, to my mind anyway, excuse me, any parallel to that in previous periods of history. Let me give you a second example, the emergence of the smartphone, which is, of course, integrated with the global spread of the internet. The first iPhone appeared in 2007. There are now calculated to be something close to 1 billion iPhones in the world and some 3 billion smartphones in the world, most of which have been manufactured since that date. You have some early analogs, but this is just an extraordinary global set of events. And I want to sort of stress a very important aspect of this, very important actually to your lives in Berlin at the moment, for reasons I'll come back to, but all of our lives. But this is the first time that cutting-edge technology has ever gone directly to the poorer countries of the world. I don't know of any previous example of that, because technologies took so long to percolate, and they were confined largely to areas of the developed world. But smartphones and mobile phones have gone directly to the very poorest countries in the world. There are more mobile phones per people in Africa than there are in the other continents, in fact, although a smaller proportion of them are still not smartphones, but that is a completely extraordinary phenomenon. So you're talking about something quite off the edge of history, really, when you're talking about these changes impacting our lives, having a global effect, having just a myriad of consequences for all of us, from the deepest parts of ourselves through to the biggest institutions. And I want to chart some of those out in what I have to say. Now, when we speak of the digital revolution, I think this has been especially true of the social sciences. Most people tend to have in mind the internet, I think, I've just been speaking about. And with good reason, because of what I've just said about its extraordinary, immediate, transformative, global impact, it makes sense. I think social sciences have been preoccupied with the internet and social media. Now, they are fantastically important, but I don't think this is the way to speak of the digital revolution, and this is not the core of what the digital revolution is, if we're going to chart it out as social scientists for its impact on the different areas of our lives. The digital revolution consists of three connected elements, deeply connected. The first is the internet. The second, however, is supercomputers. And the third is robotics. These are becoming meshed together in ways that had no precedent previously. To my mind, supercomputers are the core connection between the impact of the internet and the emergence of advanced robotics. And I don't think most people who've written about the digital revolution, at least within many areas of the social sciences, have effectively understood this and what its implications are. Essentially, you could say the iPhone in your pocket is a supercomputer. It's more powerful than the biggest supercomputers were 30 years ago. And there it is in your handbag or pocket, you've got more or less the whole of human knowledge almost accessible to you. This is quite something extraordinary. If you look at the history of supercomputers, I think to me it's deeply gripping, because here you have an analog to the internet, unbelievable advances within a relatively short period of time, which we've all come to rely on as we use our smartphones without knowing it, but is absolutely transformative for so many things in world society. One way to chart this out, you know, is by like the notable history of some of the things that have happened. One of the milestones was in 1997, when the IBM supercomputer called Deep Blue beat Garry Kasparov at chess. Garry Kasparov at that point being the world champion. That was something stupendous. I mean, after all, he's a bloody world champion, and he was beaten by a machine quite easily, and that is, you know, a few years ago now. But I think, you know, most people kind of grasp that, because you think, well, what does a computer do? It does mechanical things. It does numerals. Therefore, maybe it could be good at chess. But later, in 2011, you have a completely different scenario involving a subsequent IBM computer, this time called Watson, which beat the two world champions in the United States, believe it, on network television, at a game called Jeopardy. And Jeopardy is totally different from chess. Jeopardy is an ordinary language, general knowledge quiz. And these were the two world champions, and the supercomputer beat both of the world champions at this extraordinarily demanding set of endeavors. I mean, if for sociologists here, remember Irving Goffman. Irving Goffman was very good, as was Wittgenstein, on how complex ordinary language is and how it relates to self. Well, the supercomputer was able to master all these things more effectively than the two best people in the world. Supercomputers can now do many things which for a long while people thought computers could never do. And experts in the field said they could never do these things. One of the things, for example, was drive a car, because it was thought to be simply too complicated an activity for a computer ever to take over. And now, as everyone here will know, Google car has gone 400,000 miles without an accident, except when human beings have crashed into the back of it. And most manufacturers are busy trying to produce autonomous vehicles. When you think of the complexity of traffic behavior, this is, again, you know, quite amazing transformation. Now, as I'll be stressing through the whole of this lecture, like, this is a world of dramatic risk, and this is a world of dramatic opportunity. And the opportunities around supercomputers are pretty stunning. I've been doing quite a lot of research, as far as a lay person can, around the edges of medical science and other areas of the sciences. And some of these are poised for the most extraordinary advances. For example, in the treatment and diagnosis of cancer, where I think we can expect and are already seeing dramatic breakthroughs. Why? For two reasons, both bound up with what I'm talking about. First of all, supercomputers can decouple genetic chains in a way which is way beyond the human individual. When the Human Genome Project was set up, it took some 30 years to decipher the human genome was a collective effort. A supercomputer can do it in less than a second, what took over 25 years to achieve. And if anyone's interested in this, very good book by a bloke called Jay Vintner, V-I-N-T-E-R, called Life at the Speed of Light, which is about the overlap between supercomputers and genetics, because they both deal in information. we look solid, you know, sitting here, you look pretty solid, and I hope I look fit, but reasonably solid, I hope. But we're not, we're information. Genetics is all information. See, when you can decode it, and you can decode it quickly, and you can recombine it, the possible medical consequences are extraordinary. The second aspect, which has changed dramatically, is that scientists can now talk to one another in a direct way across the world, in an immediate fashion, just as you might do on Skype. They can do the analog of that. When you have open source material, they can trade ideas in an immediate way and exchange research findings in a fashion that wouldn't have been possible even 15 years ago. So you've got like a global dialogue going on the core areas, advanced areas of science, and this is something I think pretty dramatic. I don't know if has anyone here seen a supercomputer? Well, you should. Your whole lives are now dependent on them. A supercomputer is like three rooms this big, filled with big black cabinets with green lights that come on these cabinets. Each cabinet has six highly advanced computers, therefore several hundred of these cabinets all combined into a single network. I spent some time looking at the supercomputer Imperial College, in London, part of London University, which is one of the more cutting edge ones. And they're doing all the things I just mentioned, in medicine, for example. You can see it all represented on a gigantic screen. And they actually showed us Bitcoin. I don't know if anyone here knows about Bitcoin. It's a purely computer-generated monetary system. You can see the transactions happening in real time on this giant screen across the world. It's something quite stunning, but there you have a mind. I mean, you're in the presence. It may not be a mind like ours, but you're in the presence of something that we've never seen before, I think. And if that's not enough, the existing supercomputers seem to be on the edge of being themselves transformed by the advent of quantum computers. Quantum computers depend on quantum principles to generate a much greater range of categories than a supercomputer can do. The quantum D wave, as it's called, just a capital D, D wave, is supposedly on the edge of being functional. It's 3,000 times faster than the fastest supercomputer. You cannot comprehend that because you go and visit a supercomputer, you can't comprehend that. But I can assure you, these are embedded in most of the things you now take for granted in your life. We like live a just-in-time existence now, right? We're also used to it that we don't marvel at it. But I mean, I could have been like half an hour late coming to see Helmut, and I could have let you know that I was going to be half an hour late. You could have picked this up and you could have reorganized my visit around what I'd sent you. Much of our lives now, just-in-time lives, what is true of us is true of aircraft. Most aircraft fly most of the time through computers, I'm sure most people here will know, using GPS satellite systems. All these things are kind of everywhere, but they're also on the verge of fundamental transformation because we're only in the early stages, in my view anyway, of the digital revolution, still in the early stages. The advance of robotics is just as stunning and has to be seen as a core part of what the digital revolution is. If I can give you an example, you know, I came here on a plane today, naturally. I went through the airport. I barely saw another human being because now you have a barcode. You print out your own boarding pass. You put the barcode on the successive things you go through, including your claiming your luggage when it's been looked at. You only talk to a person if something goes wrong. Otherwise, you don't talk to a person. You can extend that because I came on the Underground, London Underground, to get to Heathrow. and I came on a train. I didn't deal with a single person the entire route, because on the underground you just put your ticket, which is a digital ticket, as you go into the underground, same when you come out. You might get some money out of a hole in the wall, what we call a hole in the wall. You don't see a person, it's all done digitally. Crucially, this is crucial to all, money is almost entirely digital. You know, a poorly understood aspect of the financial crisis is the more or less total digitalization of money, which has happened within a period of only about 15 years or so. The proportion of cash in the global economy is calculated to be 2,000 times less than it was 20 years ago, although whether that's a valid calculation, I'm not sure we can say. Everyone here who is a social scientist, I feel, should track the impact of robotics, because for something to be robotics, it doesn't have to be a personalized robot. You're talking about the automated nature of electronic technology as it invades more or less all aspects of our lives. However, as people here will no doubt know, they are building personalized robots, especially in Japan and China. Some of the robots now look pretty much like you and me. In other words, they look pretty humanoid, the latest ones. And they do all sorts of things. So you've even got robot stand-up comedians who are programmed to do what human comedians do. And they will, if you're sitting here as you are now, I notice you're not laughing very much because I'm not making very good jokes, but if you're a stand-up comedian, you've got to make people laugh. So, you know, the robot is programmed to look at your face, to see what you get a reaction from, and then to alter its jokes as it goes along like a human one does. And it does all the things that human stand-up comedians do, say, you know, oh, that wasn't a very good one, I better try something else. And it even makes it up its own jokes. I mean, since this is, you know, I'm not sure about this in English, but I mean, I could tell you a stand-up robot joke, which was actually invented by the stand-up robot comedian. It was invented by the robot. So, I mean, be prepared. It's not the world's greatest joke, really. That joke was better than the joke is. The robot says, I started going out with an Apple device. It didn't work out, though, because she was too selfish. It was always I this, I that, I the other. Aha! You got it. Well, there you go. And robots are all, as everyone will know, we're doing lots of things that we can't do ourselves. So one of the most remarkable achievements is the Rosetta project of the European Union, which has visited a comet 300 million miles away. Took 10 years going at vast speed to get there. Had to loop round the sun and another planet to get there. Landed a robot on the comet, sent back pictures that I'm sure every single person here will have seen. And then, being the European Union, the battery ran out. And so I had to stop until it got back into proximity to the sun. But none of that could have been done without all the things that I'm describing here. Now, can I stress that I don't want to be seen, no sociologist does, as a technological determinist? I hate that when you have newspapers which have a separate section labeled tech, as they often do in the UK and the US anyway, all technology is social, political, economic. This is as true of these technological changes I'm describing as it was of the original Industrial Revolution. And in the latter part of what I want to say, I want to chart out what I think is happening as a result. But I'm not a technological determinist. Technology is always embedded in a wider system of social, political, economic relationships, which, however, it can transform radically at the same time as they transform those technologies. It's creating the kind of society I mentioned earlier, what I call a high-risk, high-opportunity society. You remember one of my best mates, other people here will remember him. Ulrich Beck unfortunately died very suddenly, about 9 months ago now, wrote famous book Risk Society. He had the correct idea, that is, in contemporary societies, risk has a different nature. In many previous times, you could, in some sense or another, calculate the risks you were running. Every time you step into a car, I can tell you the risk, unfortunately, that you might be involved in an accident, because you have numerous cases which you can turn to. But the biggest risks we face today are not like that. They're what I called off the edge of history risks, because we don't have any statistical data to assess how profound they are. Helmut mentioned one of my previous books was about climate change, and I still work intensively on climate change. The risks involved with climate change are huge, I think. I think they're much more proximate, they're much more dangerous than probably the orthodox scientific community does, but you cannot assess them in advance. Therefore, it's very difficult to get political traction with off-the-edge-of-history risks, because we really don't know what the level of risk is until it's too late. Most of the bigger off-the-edge-of-history risks are like that. It's true of nuclear weapons, for example. It's true of the gigantic expansion of the world's population. It's true of the possibility of global pandemics. We do not know what the true level of risk is. Makes it very hard to get political traction, and they all have this all-too-late quality. If you get it wrong, the consequences can be stupendous, but it'll be too late to do anything about it. This is a new kind of world. But the other side of it is what I've just been referring to earlier, opportunity. The opportunities seem to me to be every bit as large as the risks, every bit as large as the risks. They weren't stressed in Ulrich's original book, which was about risk, but risk and opportunity always, always, always go together. The opportunities presented by the digital transformation of everything, if I can put it that way, are just huge. And the ones I described in the case of medicine are just one example of the opportunities we have. We know many opportunities in everyday life and many other areas too. To me, the province of sociology in the future is essentially to try and work out the parameters of the high-risk, high-opportunity society where we don't know in advance how these things will intermingle with one another. It's hugely difficult. Actually, I think it's true of personal life. I think our personal lives are unfolding along a similar dynamic. This is affecting the position of women across the world, for example, who are very much a sort of matrix of risk and opportunity as women free themselves from thousands of years of unfettered sexual domination. Well, I'd like to just mention three areas in which I think one can trace out the impact of the digital revolution in the things that are familiar to most people sitting here today. One is politics and democracy, which I think is being transformed across the world, not only by the digital revolution, but by how it interweaves with other elements. Probably some people here will know the book by Robert Putnam and Susan Farr, P-H-A-R-R, Putnam and Farr, which is called Disaffected Democracies. It looks at the recent political history of 18 democratic countries across the world, and it finds the same kind of things happening in virtually all of them. So when you think of the issues you have in Germany, or the ones we have in the UK, or the ones even there are in Greece, the outer edge of all this, these are to some extent generic, as they show. These include disaffection with political leaders, increasing mistrust of political leaders, feelings of alienation from parliament and established political institutions, a sharp decline in stable political affiliation, which used to be such a marked characteristic of the scene, and the rise of populism. All things which we're familiar with in Europe and have a particular European context, but are not simply European, they are generic. Now, they come from a combination of factors, obviously. The loss of power of the nation state in a globalized world and people's attempt still to turn to the nation state, a kind of contradictory element of late phase globalization. But I think the digital revolution is deeply, deeply involved in these changes, as well as the possibilities that could be offered for the future. It was visible to me in the last election in the UK, that just unfolded, where a lot of the pollsters' predictions were wrong. Why were they wrong? I think because they didn't give enough attention to the digital universe. They were based mostly on traditional polling. And a lot of what a lot of very ordinary people do in ordinary politics, as research seems to have demonstrated, is to play the just-in-time game that I mentioned earlier. You can delay taking a decision. Delaying taking a decision politically to the last minute doesn't mean it's an uninformed decision anymore. Even if you're like a poor person, on your smartphone, you can find out whatever you want about political leader, about the state of politics. You might choose not to look too much. But I think many people were just-in-time voters. They made up their mind at the last minute. In the case of the British election, they decided they didn't want Ed Miliband working with the Scottish nationalists, and they didn't want the Labour not to admit its culpability for at least some part of the financial crisis as it affected the UK. But we now have quite a lot of data on this, and my point would be politics looks different when you've got a supercomputer in your pocket or in your handbag, forgive me, or whatever you happen to carry it in, because political institutions look creaky, they look slow, and indeed they are creaky and they are slow compared to what it's like to live in a digital universe of activity. Now, as I said before, I don't want to say this is the determining factor, but I think it's both a crucial one, and I think it's bound to be crucial for the reconstitution of democratic politics. So far, we haven't found a way of harnessing the kind of collective enthusiasms possible in the digital universe, at least effectively. But I think if we don't, democratic systems are going to undergo a continuing strain, so we have to see if we can make electronic democracy at least partially part of the structure of day-to-day politics. There are many, many initiatives going on about that, but to me, they would mimic what's going in economic life. They would have a kind of just-in-time mobilizing, to some extent, localized character. We have got many examples, but it doesn't add up to what we need to conquer the feelings of disaffection so strong in democratic countries across the world. Second, the economy and inequality, where there is a very visible impact of the digital revolution as I'm describing it, still in its early days. As I said earlier, I don't think most economists have sufficiently picked up the significance of the emergence of electronic money when they're looking at what produced the global economic crisis, because when you can transmit money everywhere and when it has no substance, as it were, you can do things with it you couldn't do before, which is what hedge funds do, but you can make catastrophic mistakes that you couldn't make before. People can put all their cash in a tax haven instantaneously on the other side of the world to hide it from the authorities, although it might be harder to hide than it was before. So these things are pretty transformative. I think, you know, most people have gone with the idea that the global financial crisis was cyclical, but I think it's almost certainly structural. Again, I don't want to say the digital revolution is the only influence over that, but it is a pretty important one. One way of showing it is to look what's happening to the kinds of jobs that many younger people in this room might move into. We know that the combination of supercomputers and robotics is likely to knock out a very substantial proportion of middle class and even professional jobs. Not in the remote future, but in the next 15 or so years. We now have lots of studies tracking that. To some extent, it's already happened, but it's going to become radicalized. This is the reason why there isn't a sustained, one of the reasons why there isn't a sustained recovery in the US or anywhere else, because the super rich are getting the benefits of economic recovery, not those in the kinds of jobs in which aspiration and education is necessary. This is a huge, huge issue for the future. A guy called Carl Frey at the Martin School in Oxford has done a detailed study of the US labor market, and he argues that 40% of existing US jobs are vulnerable to a mixture of supercomputers and robotics within the next 15 or so years, which is quite extraordinary proportion. Now, of course, you might have many, many new jobs being created. We don't know, but the reason why there is a return of the idea of basic income, even among quite orthodox economists, is because they are deeply worried by this trend. It's hugely significant sociologically and politically because it looks as though social mobility has stalled. Social mobility has come to a halt in quite a few of the developed countries, partly because of these trends. If you knock out middle-level jobs, you're doing the opposite of what made it possible for people like me to get on in the world. Nearly all social mobility that happened in the late 20th century didn't come because people from the top moved down to the bottom, which they hardly ever do. It came because of the expansion of white-collar jobs during a period of industrial or deindustrialization, disappearance of a great deal of manual work. My father worked on the London Underground. I managed to squeeze into university and got into a decent job, although here I am still giving these crappy lectures, so I'm not sure how decent a job it was. But anyway, but that was only possible because these jobs expanded dramatically. Now, suppose what's happening, which definitely is happening at the moment, the contraction of those jobs, you can get huge issues with people stuck at the bottom. Really hard to see how they're ever going to get out. There's another very good book by Robert Putnam on this, if you're interested, called America's Kids, which tries to analyze this out and suggest possible remedies, but it could be pretty difficult. The third area I think really important to mention is the transformation of war. Most of the big inventions, including the internet, including computers themselves, including robotics, are forged through war, or at least preparation for war, for defense. And all these things are transforming the nature of war as we sit here with imponderable and unknown consequences. The Americans have 5,000 drones in the air every day across the world. What are drones? They are simply flying robots. They depend on this conjunction of internet technology and robotics and supercomputers I'm talking about. They are lethal where they operate, and they operate invisibly. For anyone who's interested in these things, there's a very good book called The Thistle and the Drone, which is about American use of drones against the Taliban in rural Pakistan. If you're a villager there, people just get killed. You don't know when it's coming or where it comes from. You see nothing of what's happening to you. You look at the drone operators sitting in North Carolina somewhere. They know everything about the people they're going to kill. They have infrared cameras. They track them on a daily basis. The drone operators say they know more about the people that they're tracking than they do about their next door neighbors, which shows you something about contemporary war. This is a pretty dramatic transformation of war. And robotics is advancing everywhere in war technology. You now have the Americans having 3D printers on their battleships. They will be able to build reasonable level drones without moving into port and build other instruments of war with 3D printing. You'll be able to do the same thing positively on Mars and on the moon as well, but negatively you're going to build this weaponry without calling into port. It's just amazing transformation of war. Battlefield robots are already here. They move faster than human beings. They can see further than human beings. Who knows what the consequences will be, but they are quite extraordinary. And I'd like to, just before sort of getting to a conclusion and letting you all escape, all of this is transforming the affairs of the moment. So if you think of Islamic State is a 21st century organization. It is not a medieval theocracy, even though it draws on traditions of the past or exaggerated traditions. ISIS deploys cutting-edge electronic technology. It employs sophisticated hackers and computer specialists. It is calculated that 3/4 of the population of the world have seen a video of a beheading, even though they might not necessarily admit to it. This is something also quite extraordinary. See, network terrorism is a part of all this, and this is like conjunction of the theocratic medieval and the cutting edge of digital technology, such as we've never seen before. There's a huge difference between Islamic State and Al-Qaeda, which are now at loggerheads with one another. And I think the same thing is true of migration, because we sit here, the papers, as I read them, coming on the plane, full of that tragic picture of the little boy who was washed up on the beach in Turkey, dead, being carried away from the beach by a Turkish policeman. Horrific picture which has struck the conscience of Europe, as it should do. Other tragic pictures. What is going on here? Well, what is going on is in some part of the world I'm describing. This is a world where everything is visible, and everything is visible to people in the poorest countries, just as it is here. So I could be a member of Islamic State, let's say. I could behead somebody and I could send it around the world on a video, and then I could tune into BBC iPlayer and I could watch people like me talking in the House of Lords in a debate about Islamic State. What kind of world is that? That is something, you know, quite sort of difficult to comprehend. And the migrants themselves are not like traditional migrants. And the New York Times published a really interesting set of articles on this yesterday, particularly the migrants who are coming from the Balkans, many of whom are heading for Germany, as you know, are using smartphones. They track their progress using GPS satellite positioning. They're in constant touch with the people they left behind. They're in touch with one another. They find out about what they're going in detail before they go there. The people we would call traffickers advertise on the internet, just like people here, you know, get holiday homes on the internet. This is a world of newly saturated information where you cannot assume that because someone comes from a poor country, they're not as sophisticated as you or I might be in using digital devices to structure what they're up to. I actually think we wouldn't have had this period of migration if it hadn't have been for this conjunction. It's certainly channeling large parts of it. Not all of it, because you've got poor, desperate souls coming through from Africa who are not in this category, but have a substantial portion of people who are organizing and often self-organizing it, not dependent on traffickers to do so, and are outguessing the authorities because they can track what the authorities are doing on the internet anyway. See, even this period, a huge issue for Europe of mass migration, is deeply impacted by these things. Finally, in conclusion, you know, you can't leave it there because this is the most profound set of revolutions ever, and I can't conclude without mentioning the debate about singularity. I don't know how many people here know what singularity is. Anybody know? Yes, excellent, quite a few people. Singularity is the term that's been adopted to refer to the point at which intelligent machines will simply surpass human beings in most areas of cognition and thought and capacity, something they've already started to do. Singularity is the point at which human beings will actually merge with machines and might become different themselves. This is not something, at least some people think, for the remote future. There's something, again, for the next 20 or 30 years. For anyone who's interested in this, the great guru of singularity is called Ray Kurzweil, K-U-R-Z-W-E-I-L. Ray Kurzweil is a Californian entrepreneur who actually invented pop music as you know it, because he invented synthesizers about 30 years ago. He's now the technical director of Google, actually. And he wrote this book, which made a big impact on me. He's kind of my guru, I suppose, called The Singularity Is Near. The Singularity Is Near, in which he argues this process of transcendence could happen within the lifetimes of at least the very younger people sitting in this audience. And you ought to listen, because he thinks immortality is part of this future. Because immortality could take many forms of combination, right, between human beings and intelligent machines, especially as you can replace more and more body parts. And if you could, for example, mimic the human brain on a computer, which we're not close to but may become close to, you could download it into clone bodies, for example. You could decide how long to live and as whom, or at least a small proportion of humanity could. Kurzweil says this is likely to happen within the next 30 years. In other words, likely to happen within the lifetimes of people now, such is the pace of advance in the areas converging. Now, I have to say, not everybody agrees with that. And, you know, we live in a don't-know world when we're living in a high-opportunity, high-risk society, but we don't really know. But his reasoning is persuasive. It could happen, I think. See? In conclusion, you think of the world that we are living in and the world that younger people are entering in. It's like a world to me, if you redefine the notion of high opportunity, high risk society, suspended between immortality on the one hand and Armageddon on the other, because there's no doubt that we could destroy large chunks of our civilization, our global civilization. There's no doubt in my mind that this could happen. Well, you know, Armageddon and immortality are properties of the gods, not human beings. And it's not clear to me, as a sociologist, that human beings are capable of dealing with the world which we as human beings have created. And that's the kind of global paradox of the 21st century. Final conclusion, one mustn't succumb to all these things. Many of the ways in which we will deal with the world saturated by the digital revolution should be low-tech ways of adapting, everyday ways of adapting. You know, at one point the motor car seemed to be the future. Now in many cities it's back to walking, back to cycling. Good for health, very good. I don't really like lecturing using a computer to display my wares, so I simply stick with a piece of paper, which is as back to the future as you can get. Thank you very much for your attention.
Stay down here.
Well, I think so, yes, because I mean, there is a period for questions if anybody feels like asking them, and if you could follow my tortured English.
That's it, yes.
Why don't you open the back door? Because it's so hot in here. This is like sort of miniature global warming, really, you know.
Thank you for an interesting speech. My name is Chris Newman. I'm here, first year MPP student. I have a question about one aspect of the digital transformation that you didn't touch on explicitly, the Internet of Things. We're expected to have 50 billion sensors by 2050 connecting everything. And I'm interested in specifically the political aspect of this, because these sensors will provide so much information that corporations and governments will have near perfect behavioral data about us. What is your take on how this should be dealt with in terms of data access, privacy, and the power issues that comes with this?
Yeah, thanks. Very good question. I mean, personally, I don't like the phrase Internet of Things, because first of all, I think it's not just the internet we're talking about, and second, I think everything is already penetrated by the digital revolution, so I didn't myself use the term Internet of Things. You know, I think it suggests the rest of it are not things, but these things I'm talking about are everywhere in our material lives, so there's no such separate thing for me as the Internet of Things. There are areas like, you know, the digitalized home and that kind of thing. And what you're saying about that is completely correct, because, you know, this is a dangerous set of changes, I've been trying to emphasize, not by any means a wholly benign set of changes. And in a world where nothing is private and everyone can see what's happening to you, then it's not in a case that it's easy to disclose things that people don't want disclosed, but as you're saying, increasingly, the many areas of the world dependent upon digital technology. These include energy systems, for example, so they're pretty vulnerable to cyber attack unless you set up defense systems. So this would apply to anything in a, you know, in the home or anything else you want to include with the Internet of Things. So the more information you get, the more we're dependent on digital transformation, the more vulnerable we all are to spying, to criminality. The level of criminality, you know, the so-called dark net is gigantic. You know, Bitcoin originated partly as a kind of, not wholly, but partly as a kind of criminal endeavor. So the more the digital technology is integrated, as you would say, and let's say how a house functions, whatever it might be, the more this carries huge vulnerabilities along with it. And so we have to try and build that into whatever we, in terms of politics especially, we decide to do in these areas. Because I think digital technology could actually transform renewable energies, you see. And that's what Elon Musk, if you've heard of him, lots of people must have heard of Elon Musk. I mean, he's interesting. He invented this electric car, the Tesla, which can go 300 miles without having to be recharged, unlike a Nissan Leaf. And he's just invented this sort of large domestic battery which could store renewable energy. If we could find, using digital technology, a means of storing energy on the large scale, forgive me, it would transform energy systems, because one of the problems with renewable energy, you know very well in Germany, because you're the pioneers in some of these things, is its intermittent nature, still dependent on fossil fuels around the edges. So the risks are huge, and again, the opportunity are huge. I think the supply's there as in other areas, really. And there's no simple formula to me. The hugely dangerous world we're entering, and huge opportunities going along with it. I don't know how we're going to find our way through it as individuals or collectively.
Hello, thank you for the talk. It was very, very interesting. I'm an MPP student here, first year. My name is Nicholas. And my question was, I was thinking about Alan Turing during your talk and the impact that he had in World War II. Now, you also mentioned the example of a person tuning into a video in the IS state, about the IS state, and then someone tuning into the BBC and then hearing in Parliament talking about it. Now, my question is, how do you think this singularity and this evolution of technology, digital technology, is going to change the way we see policy and the way that we make policy?
Well, you mentioned Turing in the beginning, didn't you? Yeah, I mean, yeah, a lot of people will have seen the film about Turing, obviously. And that makes the point I was making, you know, situated in the context of war. And many of the things associated with these revolutions, including rockets, obviously, space travel originated in the Second World War, jet engines as well, so, you know, lots of it. Turing's really interesting as a person. I think it was good to make a film about him. I mean, he was in my college, King's College, and there is a kind of history of sexuality, as there is around many, many things, I think, actually, in it all. This was a time when you couldn't admit to being homosexual. We know what happened to him, but even when I got to King's quite a long while ago, there was still the residue of all that, which was sort of in people's minds. So I've got even a sort of individual connection with all of that. And, you know, it was a true tragedy, but he was some kind of genius, I think. I'm not really a believer in geniuses, but he must have been, I think. And think of what he's done to the world. And he made some projections from the future, which are a bit similar to what's actually happened, including, as I understand it, the possibility that we could be transcended by some different kind of intelligence. So he was quite a remarkable figure. What was the last part of your question? Oh, well, the impact on how we do policy, you can't say will, because it's just everywhere already. Just so many. I mean, you take healthcare, for example. It's plain that wearable devices are going to be a key part of medical care and medical involvements for the future, for older people and for younger people too. You can monitor a person's health in a routine way pretty easily already. These have become more and more detailed. I mean, these things, they're not of the future. These things are of the present. We already organize a great deal of our policy around some version of the digital revolution without possibly even knowing it. I mean, you get a sense of it like in everyday life. I got off the plane, right? In the old days, you got off a plane, people would look ahead and they'd be interested where they're going. Now where they're looking, they're all looking down on their bloody devices. They have to switch them on immediately. The plane engines stop. They're not just devices, they are their lives in a way now. It's, you know, don't can't see it as a device. There's a very good cartoon in the English satirical magazine Private Eye where Martians come and invade the Earth and someone's saying, look, Martians are invading the Earth. And he says, oh, well, don't bother, because everyone is busy looking down at their devices all the time. They're not interested. It's already so much part of policy. And there's so many things you can do that you couldn't do before. I mean, when money is electronic, economic policy is quite different in many respects from previously. So you ask what Greek debt is. What the hell is, you know, I know in Germany you don't like Greek debt very much, but what the hell is debt? It's just a load of digits in somebody's computer. You know, hard to work actually what debt actually is to me, and you can sort of understand it, but what does it mean to say Greeks are hugely in debt and there's no money anymore anywhere? So, I think it's just everywhere, really. We just don't realize it because we're already so accustomed to organizing our lives in these ways. And I think this applies to sexuality, applies to personal identity. And I mean, think of migration, as I mentioned, because, like, supposing you're a Chinese immigrant in London, you can talk to your family every day, see them on your device, they can talk back to you on Skype, you can talk for as long as you like, and it doesn't cost anything. No one would have thought that was possible even a few years ago, especially it doesn't cost anything. There's an interesting book by a guy called Paul Mason called Post-Capitalism, in which he argues that we might be entering a world where the traditional mechanisms of value no longer apply. See, capitalism might destroy itself, not for the traditional Marxian reasons, but because we're moving into a world where many things are free and can be self-organized, and where the logic of markets doesn't apply in the same way. I think it's maybe a bit exaggerated, but it's quite an interesting book. It's called Post-Capitalism.
Hi, thanks a lot for your talk. I'm a second-year student here at Hertie as well, and just a quick question for me, which is, what do those opportunities and threats mean for people like us who will be entering the job market in the next few years? How do we prepare ourselves to take advantage of those opportunities and protect ourselves against those threats?
Well, that's a very good question, and I hope that I touched on it a bit in what I said, because it looks as though there is a contraction of opportunities for the kinds of things that higher education used to prepare you for. That is, professional jobs, even quite advanced professional jobs, will increasingly be done by supercomputers. So there's a real issue of what will happen to your generation, to me. And I don't want to sound too negative about it, because we know that all these changes create a lot of new jobs, and a lot of these new jobs are pretty interesting ones. They're often like just built on just-in-time capabilities. Like, if you go, hardly anyone goes to a travel agent anymore, for example, because you can easily organize your holiday using this mixture I'm describing. So there may be many different kinds of jobs. Nobody knows, but I think it's a serious issue for your future. And, we don't know a world is what I'm describing, because the level of change is so fast, we just don't know what will happen. So you might find, loads of really great jobs around, but, you're moving into this don't-know world, and I think this mixture of risk and opportunity applies to all of us, actually, so I don't have some magical formula to say you're going to get a great job, but I hope you do, and I hope you get whatever job you want. Don't be an academic, though, because... Well, do be an academic. It's not a bad life. Just don't get any money, but otherwise it's all right. Why are there no ladies asking questions?
There's a lady back there.
So. Uh-huh. Hello, I'm Henrike Hertz. I used to study at Hertie. Now I'm trying to make it look like government was still in charge. So all, of course, I'm interested in is control. You mentioned the singularity, and it sounded like it was just a process that was about to happen to us. What would you say, given the fact that government is still trying to make processes that control things that happen to people? Are we able to get back into control, or is it something that's just going to happen to us?
Well, it depends, I think, who the we is and what kind of control you have in mind, really, because, we are now 7 billion people on the face of the earth. Till 1850, there was never more than, there's never a billion people till 1850. So who the we is, I suppose, could be collective humanity, or it could be, you and your mates, I'm not quite sure, but... We're here in this world, and we have to see how we can maximize the opportunities, reduce the risks, basically, and I think that applies all the way across the board. So it applies in the job market as it does elsewhere. And I think it applies to women very forcefully, because we're in the middle of, probably the greatest gender revolution ever, because never been a world in which women are remotely equal to men. There is... no equality now, but nevertheless, there is a global movement of transformation, and so that's producing a new world as well, and we don't know. That's not easy to handle. I'm not sure if that's the question you asked, though, was it?
I was very impressed by your speech.
Oh, well, I'll go home now, then. That's a good thing to say.
But...
yeah, I knew you were going to say but. It always is when people say that.
Here in Germany, we are pretty worried about surveillance. And you did not talk much about surveillance. Privacy was mentioned. But what could you tell us about the future development of surveillance devices, as you tell us, regarding the drones and the use of the drones? If this is used politically, what are you thinking about the future of democratic societies?
Well, those two things are slightly different from one another. I mean, I'm thinking about drones quite a lot, actually, because I'm speaking in debate in the British Parliament about it next week, where there is new EU regulation supposedly coming in to help control drones, because it won't be long at this rate before a civil airliner is brought down by a drone. And I don't know if anyone's looked on the internet, but if you go to Amazon, you can get about 300 different kinds of drones which you can fly immediately. And you could use them to spy on your wife or husband. You could use them to spy on your neighbors. You know, so the issue of surveillance is a huge, huge one. Newspapers use them to spy on celebrities. I don't think that is right and proper. So as the previous questioner was saying, you know, can I stress again, I'm not saying this is a benign world, I've stressed all the way through, it's a real mixture of threat and opportunity. And this applies in the area of surveillance because you can do amazing things with drones. Just to give one example, you can use them to check different kinds of industrial procedures, mining, above ground mining, oil installations at sea, renewable technology without anybody going near them. You can carry out environmental classification, very useful climate change studies using drones. You can have drones which you can send into forest fires where human pilots would not go. So like everything I'm saying, this is a huge mixed bag. But the issue of surveillance, if that means spying on people, is just generic to all this. And I see no simple solutions whatsoever. I just see an evolving situation. And I see that all the way through from personal life through to your bank account and my bank account through to supposedly state secrets. I think the threat of organized cyber attack at some point is really large. And this is the most dangerous time for the European Union that I can remember, I think. Because of the convergence of the problem of the Ukraine, the problem of huge migration, the problem of the incapacities of the euro, and all this is operating against the background of all that. And so, I'm sure that the Russians are prepared to launch a cyber attack if they think they need to against Western Europe, where I'm sure NATO has some capabilities to. It's just a huge, huge part of it all, and so I can't offer any simple say, how are you going to protect your bank account? But I think, all these things I'm suggesting, a lot of things will be low-tech solutions. So I don't know if people here have tried it, but I counted out and I got 38 different passwords. Many people here might not have quite as many, but if you include the one you do for the whole of the war for the bank, the one I have to get into Parliament, etc., comes to 38. Some of them are always changing, because in Parliament, this is a terrorist target. We have to be really careful with surveillance. So how are you going to deal with that? Well, I think the best way is you write it down on a bit of paper and you lock it in a cupboard in your office. Is the best way to protect your passwords that I can think of. So I'm looking for a real mixed. I don't think most solutions to how you find a decent life in all this are going to be high-tech solutions. I think a lot of them, hopefully, will be low-tech solutions. And also resistance against some aspects of this sort of imponderable world as well. We might have to fight back against it collectively. But I just think, as a sociologist, there's never been anything quite like this before, because original industrial revolution was huge, 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 but it took ages to become diffused from Britain to the rest of the world. And we've lived through this in about 20 years in terms of its impact on our lives thus far. So that's why I don't have any pat solutions and say this is how you're going to protect people's bank accounts or whatever it might be, because everything is vulnerable to me. Everything, I think, is vulnerable to whoever knows what they're doing. It's very, difficult because you can't extricate yourself from these things because, you could keep all your money in cash, but it would be quite difficult to do in physical cash. You could do. People in Greece do it, of course, for different reasons.
Thank you. I think we have time for one more question. And would be you. And apologies to everybody who couldn't ask the question, but I think... We'll have a reception afterwards, and I think Tony may be around for a few minutes.
Are we going to sing the Hertie School of Governance song then?
No, not tonight. That'll be tomorrow.
I enjoyed your lecture very, very much. My name is Katrin Bastian from Liechtenstein Embassy.
in Berlin. My question is, what might be the impact of the digital age on social structure of our societies? Will there, will the class, society of class system come to an end? And will there be a class of people who are able to handle the electronic devices and those who are too stupid to do it, like myself? Will there be a two-class system?
You're handing an electronic device as you're speaking. Well, I think beginning at the end, I don't think anyone is too stupid. I mean, I'm not talking about the future only, I'm talking about the present. I think we're already living, for better or for worse, in this kind of system. It's sort of integral to more or less everyone's lives. You can try and stand outside it, and you can do it to some degree, but it's pretty hard. You can do it, but you have to make a real effort. So, you know, I would resist the idea, your sort of self-deprecation that you're stupid and you can't manage. And interestingly, in quite a few countries, there's no longer a difference between the old and the young, because a lot of people say, only my grandchildren can do this. But actually, in many countries we've looked at in this study, I didn't do the study, somebody else's, you know, older people have picked up these technologies very quickly. And as I said, people in societies without much technology have, because you look at what the migrants from Syria are doing, you look at these articles in the New York Times I mentioned, you know, they know, do lots of things that I don't know how to do using their devices. So I don't think that's a sort of serious issue. Around it, there are so many issues. So, you know, I can't really answer your question, because we just don't know what is going to happen to job structures. We don't know what's going to happen to the economy. We don't know what's going to happen to war, because the change is too huge, too rapid. So all we can do is monitor them and try and, you know, in terms of social structure, you know, contextualize it, see what's happening in certain areas. So in certain kinds of jobs, you can see those jobs disappearing more or less as we speak. You can see other ones coming into prominence. We don't know how it will pan out. That's why you don't really know, like in a previous generation, you know, what your opportunities will really be. I think that's really hard to say, but it is kind of everywhere, because, you know, I was going to try and spend a weekend in a country cottage, and I got in touch with these people I assumed were estate agents, but they're actually both computer specialists. And you can hire this cottage on a daily basis if you want to. They'll arrange for whatever meal you want to be there. They'll tailor it all to you. It's not very expensive either. They do it all through smartphone. Couldn't have done that before. You know, I think sociologically, economically, as a lay person, all we can do is think about it, because we don't actually know in many areas what the consequences really will be, except that, as I've stressed, some of them could be really noxious and dangerous to us all. But I think it's reshaping more or less everything, in my opinion, what it's worth. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you for your questions. Thank you to Helmut, your noble boss.
Well, thank you very much, Tony. Thank you very much for being here tonight, for asking good questions. I should say two things before we leave. First, there were so many people interested in attending tonight's lecture that we could not accommodate everybody. So, Tony, we had 5 invisible drones tape the lecture and also the questions. We did tape the lecture.
Drone to bring my supper.
And we will put it up on the Hertie School website. Alternatively, we could copy your speech as well. That'd be very analog,
good
wouldn't
luck
it?
To you if you do that.
Yeah. And then there is an announcement regarding tomorrow. Tomorrow is going to be the official opening ceremony here at the school, and we have Katrin Suda. She's the Secretary of State in the Ministry of Defense, giving the inaugural speech when tomorrow, when we start a new program, the Master of International Affairs. Thank you very much for coming, and come back soon. Thank you.